Hello and welcome to our Women's Walk with Christ vlog, Speaking Life. My name is Margaret Hilton and this is my co-host, Kim Turner.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to our 14th, 15th
episode. We're up to 17 now.
What? See, I lost track. We've done so many. Well, welcome. We're so excited to have you all here. And this will be our first show after our first Women's Walk weekend after 15 months on break. Mm-hmm. So it's super exciting that we finally got that out, and a lot of wonderful God walking moments while we were on the weekend. And we'll get to that at the end of the show, but we have a very special guest today. Our guest today has been in Women's Walk. I think she was on one of the first weekends.
She was on the very first weekend.
Mm-hmm. I think so. And a lot of you have probably met her, at least had some contact with her. She is the nurse for most of our weekends, as well as an amazing, nurturing, wise woman. And coincidentally, for Margaret and I both, she was our spirit circle leaders on our weekend. So we are ecstatic to introduce Lucy Gerken to our show this week.
Hi, Lucy.
Hi.
Hi, Lucy.
Hi, Margaret. Hi, Kim.
How are you?
I'm good. I want you to know this is not me wearing a mask wrong, which is one of my absolute pet peeves during mask season when people wear their mask on their chin. This is just a bandage for the last stage of a tiny little skin cancer I had that's taken 8 months to complete treatment for.
Oh my gosh.
I know.
I think somebody called that this weekend. It's not a diaper chin. Put your mask up. It's like, oh, that is a good one. A diaper.
Yes.
I've
yes.
heard chin strap.
Chin diaper.
Not a yeah. chin strap.
Either way, it drives me crazy.
Right. It has a lot of names.
Yeah.
So first, Lucy, what we would like for you to do is if you could start with your mission statement and then tell us when you did your weekend.
Okay. Well, I did my weekend in March of 2006. So it was the first official weekend that I got invited to by some people who knew me. Yeah.
That's what we thought, that you were on the very first weekend.
I was. It was a different weekend than people see now.
It's changed just a little bit, Lucy.
You know, we're this ministry of transformation. It's been a lot of transformation over the years with every part. So my mission statement is, as a grateful woman walking humbly with Christ, I co-create a world of hope, peaceful joy, and confident trust by daily seeking, accepting, and following God's guidance, and by encouraging others to do the same. And then I always want to say amen.
You can. Amen,
I'm in, bless you, whichever.
Yeah.
Whatever works. That's beautiful. Yeah. Thank you for sharing that.
You're welcome.
Okay. So go ahead, Margaret.
Yeah. So our first question, and I've said this before, and Lucy is a very faithful follower of our show. And so she already knows this, but for others of you who are new to our show, we send out a list of questions for people to answer and let them pick what they want to talk about. And one of the first questions that I'm going to ask you is about the Enneagram. And guess what number she is, Kim?
I can't even imagine that there's another two on our show.
I'm very proud to say we have yet another two on the Enneagram on our show.
Well, I just got Margaret's text and it said, what Enneagram number are you? And I started to say, sorry, Margaret, but oh no, it's another two. But
I'm not sorry.
Maybe it's a different kind of two.
Well, tell us about your two-ness and how you use the Enneagram and what you like about it.
So I was like, what hasn't been said about a two? The first time I did an Enneagram thing, I had two really strong wings, right? I was like, I have some one tendencies and I have some three tendencies. And then I have this two in the middle. So sometimes I really identify with the, like, I was angry for years and years and years. So that's a thing, right? And like, I like things to be complete. So it kind of blends a bunch together. but I would like for everything to be equal in our world. I would like justice. I would like equality. I counted out M&Ms for my kids, 6 piles, all the same color, so they wouldn't fight over it. And then I ate the extras, right? So
that was your favorite.
There's that. Yeah. Yeah. And then like 3, you know, I think I really like to be specific and I really like to be efficient. And I really, really like to finish whatever I start. So there's this efficiency thing of a 3. And I don't remember a whole lot more about 3s off the top of my head, but, and then in the middle, like I always wanted to be a mother. I always wanted to be a nurse. I loved animals. You know, if I could fix everybody and make everybody happy, that would be awesome. You know, so, and then I was just thinking yesterday, I was looking over these questions and, my profession, because I always knew I wanted to be a nurse. I wanted to be a nurse or a teacher, but I went with nursing. And in nursing, you get to be a teacher a lot.
Right.
So there's a lot of teaching when you're a nurse. Yeah. So yeah, it was perfect. I got to be both. So I was a NICU nurse. I started really high level of nursing. And then I did almost everything in the mother baby realm. And then I did like the medium risk nursery, and then I did mom baby, and then I did the newborn admit nursery, and so I did all of that kind of stuff. Then I took classes so I could be a childbirth educator, which is like Lamaze. Think Lamaze, right? So then I nurtured those. I got to teach and nurture those young couples coming in not having any idea what parenthood was about, and how their bodies, how they could trust their bodies to actually let these babies come out. And not live in fear, but in trusting their bodies. So all of this stuff is really connected. Not too long after that, I started counseling breastfeeding moms,
wow,
which is another huge nurturing thing. So that's really a one, like every time I went to a mother's room, I would be like, this mother needs to know she can care for her child. I mean, the basic thing, if I can't feed my child, I can't be a good mother, right? So it's a lot of confidence building. So yes, you can feed your baby. Yes, your body's going to work, you know, things like that. So, and then my own children and my own grandchildren and things like that. So it's, one of my daughters said to me the other day, she saw that, just that little 5-minute clip. And she sent me a message back and said, Mom, this is like what you used to do in nursing, only it's not medical.
Because, it is.
Yeah, because I'm still walking alongside women to support them, to be with them in their pain, because out of pain comes good. You know, it's just all those things. It was like, life is tough and we walk through it, but it's like got these glorious moments and good rewards and strength building and just lots of good stuff. So.
And like you say, even in the dark times, you know, he's there too. And it's good to be able to walk with women while they're doing that and process that and figure out,
yeah,
you know, to the other side of that. So that's,
yeah. So, and then I just, with the Enneagram, I just love all the different numbers because there's something in each of them. And I go, sometimes I'm that. And then sometimes I go, ooh, sometimes I'm that, because it's like, I don't like those parts. Yeah.
Is there a number that you wish that you were other than 2? Have you ever wanted to be another number?
Oh, gee. And some of them I just don't understand at all. You know, I mean, I would like to be a peacemaker. I mean, I'd love to be, you know, that's part of fix. I would like to be a peacemaker, but some of the more past, some of the less directed parts of that, I'm like, no, I would just rather just say it straight up, you know, and not. Like, I'd rather be more, not aggressive, but more, what's the word? Help me.
Direct.
More direct. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So I don't think, I kind of like my blend. And I like to hold on to some of the good parts of some of the others and try to look at the parts I don't like. And yeah. Or somebody else points them out to you. Thank you very much.
Right.
But it's good.
I didn't need you to point that out. I got it.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Or I forgot. You're right. Dang it. Yeah. That.
Well, and even before you said you were a two, I knew, I had a hunch that you were a two, even before you told us, just because you and I are similar in our service, and you're similar in like what you just said of wanting to fix, like there's a solution to this problem. Let's just fix it, you know, instead of that's when we talk about like the weekends and one of, you know, the things that we do and the things that we don't do. And that's one of my biggest struggles is, you know, just offering the quick fix, you know, or the answer to the problem, you know, instead of working it through with a woman.
Yeah. And then over time we get better at going, okay, it's not mine.
Right. Yeah.
Like the ducks don't have this. I don't have to get the ducks in the row. They're not my ducks. I learned that from Mo in my spirit circle, not my ducks. Yeah. And just letting it go and deciding what's my business and what's not my business. What's my decision on something that somebody else have a completely different thing on, because I'm not in control of anything but my own little sphere, my own thoughts, my own feelings, my own decisions. You know, it takes time. And I'd like to think I've gotten better with practice, but I still slip into every once in a while.
So you say ducks and I say monkeys, not my circus, not my monkeys.
Mm-hmm. I think I've had a lot of circuses at my house.
So they are your monkeys.
Yeah, a lot of those are your monkeys.
They birthed them little monkeys. Yeah.
So I do have a question that's not on the list, because you were talking about your grandkids and your kids. And so you have 6 children. How many grandchildren do you have?
17.
17 grandchildren. And how many have you been there and for the birth of?
All of them except these last 2 little babies that were born in COVID season, and then it wasn't allowed.
But every other one, you were in the room.
I was.
Wow.
Yeah. So that was like some mental and accepting, letting go, and just, it's okay. I'll see them later, or I get to keep, you know, stay with the 2 big brothers when Carla's last baby was born, or I'll get to see little baby Ike a day or two after they get home. And I have no control. Let go and prayed and trusted and prayed for them to have an awesome labor and delivery nurse and an understanding doctor, and things went really well. So,
that's awesome.
Yeah.
So that was different for each of your daughters too. They were used to having you in there to learn how to.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you think you'll have more
grandkids? Well, I think the girls are probably finished. You know, I have 5 daughters in a row. I think the girls are probably done. But Isaac just has his first. So I don't know what their plans are, but I think there's a good chance there'll be another 1 or 2, but I don't know.
Maybe you'll hit 20.
I was just going to say.
Isaac, when you have 3 more kids, I get an even number, then I can remember it better when I get older.
Exactly. You can always remember you're a 2 on the Enneagram and you have 20 grandkids. Like 2.
Then I could only have to use 2 fingers the rest of my life.
Yeah. That's just funny.
Peace. Okay.
Which is part of your mission.
Yes. Yes.
It's just peace, all going to blend together, Lucy.
Yes. A lot of things blend together.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for sharing about your Enneagram. We appreciate it. And we always love to have 2s on the show.
Margaret. Okay, so question number 2. How has God changed your life through Women's Walk with Christ?
Well, yeah. And there's kind of a combination of things, too. Because before I was in Women's Walk, I was in a 12-step program called Al-Anon. And some people don't know what that is, but it's not for a drinking problem. It's if you have a loved one with a drinking or drug problem, right? So I was in this 12-step thing. So when I walked into the first meeting there, I wasn't very involved at first, but they have these 12 steps. And I read those and I was like, those could just be paraphrased from the Bible. So I believe in the Bible. I believe in the 12 steps, and then I come to Women's Walk and the 10 agreements. I look at those and go, those are very similar to the 12 steps. Those are very similar. Yeah. So like those 3 things in my life, really just, I was like, okay, this is the places I belong. And I felt really comfortable with that. But I, because of frustrations out of lack of control or not feeling appreciated and things like that. I was, like I said, I was angry for a long, long time. So just a couple of years ago, I was asked if I would be willing to give an anger testimonial. And I was like, I don't know if I can, because I don't remember why I was so angry for all those years. Mm-hmm. So that's a huge thing, that Women's Walk and the work I've done in circles and through Al-Anon has done. Yeah. So that's a really huge thing. Also, I don't take so many things personally. Like, don't take it personally. And the key there was, I heard that, don't take things personally. They aren't necessarily forced on you, but I took on. So that was like a really key thing to think. Don't take things personal. It's like, I don't have to take it. I can go, not mine. Right. Mm-hmm. Or change, you know, kind of reframe it that way. I've had some unexpected times of really deep healing that I didn't expect. One that really stands out for me is, my dad had already died, and I did some work to try to reconcile his relationship and mine, which was pretty stormy once I got, hormonal independent teenager kind of stuff. And I did this piece of work with one of my sisters in Spirit Circle facilitating that gave me such a huge amount of clarity about who he was and why he was the way he was. And he and I could be at peace. We could let the death actually just go, oh, now I get it. And understand why he was the way he was. And then I could understand why he acted the way he did towards me, which was just like really overprotective. And he wanted to control me so he could protect me because he wasn't protected as a kid. Anyway, it was just a really big thing that I got complete peace with. I don't feel any old, I can remember things, but I don't ever feel angry or upset with him anymore. So it's just like a true cleansing, and almost like it disappeared in that way. So yeah, some things like that and some deep pieces I've had where I can remember those images I had in my head at the end of the work, because we were grounding my work, that I can go back to those images and get that same piece back, that same resolution, or, get that back by remembering those images. Also, things have grown, like teamwork, confidence, ways to be in leadership, ways to just be part of the team. A lot of really graced friendships. I have so many wonderful women friends that I met through Women's Walk, because it's just such, okay, I'm going to use sacred ground again. It's sacred ground because if you share these really important things and these spiritual things and these deep things with women, it just opens up the door to love and accept so much better. So like just amazing friendships and closeness with people. And I really like small groups, and I really like individual times a lot. So that's some of the highlights of how women's
your life has changed.
Yeah.
In beautiful ways.
Well, and we've really appreciated your leadership skills. You've been on the management team for many, many years, and you have a lot of important roles in our ministry. And we're very grateful that you keep track of all the women in Spirit Circles, and you're so detailed, and all of your health coordinator contributions, you know, for all of your medical knowledge that you have. And it's been a real asset to our ministry for sure.
Well, thank you. Oh, and this is just a little thing about when you said in the health field kind of thing. So it's that and other things too. And I'm not sure where this fits in, but here's a basic education, and you have this ladder framework, and then, or like kind of scaffolding. And then the more you learn, the more you fill it in. And the more you've got more scaffolding built, the easier it is for things to fill in. Well, that works for like medical information, and that works for human relationships. thing. So I love to learn. That's one of my things I love. I like the details. I like the specifics. I like to learn and keep learning new things. So that fits in somewhere.
Yeah. Well, and you were just talking about the beautiful sisterhood of our ministry, and that fits in nicely with our next question of why is it important for you to be in a spirit circle?
I've expressed this like probably every bridge I've ever helped with, which is many, let me think how to say this. So here's kind of what it looks like, is to like have that vulnerability and have that courage to go ahead and say things about yourself that are not pretty, to go ahead and express your deepest emotions, your deepest, I'm just going to say ugliness or judgments or whatever, to get through the steps that we work through. And then to look up and see the faces of your sisters in the spirit circle, and they're not going, oh, or, oh, they're not doing any of that. They're like, they're just like these looks of love, and their faces like understand and accept, and it's unconditional love. And it's like, whoa, really? Like, and that in doing that, because I've been in the same circle the whole time, and I've been in some other circles part-time, but I've always been in this circle. But we keep getting to know each other better and better. It's like, oh my gosh, we're so close. We could never be closer. Yep. We still get closer. Right. Yeah. So that's a really big thing. And there's accountability there, you know, that I can say something, they'll go, hey, Luce, what about, you know, and ask a question or point something out that I don't want to see or I can't see because I'm all stirred up or I'm in such a different frame of mind that I'm not being perceptive about myself, that they can see something I don't. Mm-hmm. And so the honesty there and the accountability and calling me to accountability and responsibility also. So there's a lot of growth in that. You can't just have people say, oh, that's okay, don't worry about it. You know, you can't change unless sometimes you're challenged. Yeah. And it's a really big deal because spirit circle is maintenance. Sometimes I've had to skip for periods of time, but it's really good maintenance to kind of keep from backsliding and to stop falling back into old patterns that I don't really want to be doing. And yeah, it's also a really good place to be able to look back. It's like you have something that triggered, you know, it's like, anyway, so there's something that you go, oh, I'm all upset about something. And then you go, wait a minute, that seems familiar. And you can look back to remember and look back to learn, but not in a regretful way, not to be self-blaming or regretful, but to go, oh, I don't have to start back at square one. I'm already here. I just need to catch myself here and remember what I already learned. So that's a really helpful thing too.
Yeah, I think it's like how you're saying, it's like a checkpoint in the game. Like if you get to a certain point in the game, you don't have to start at the beginning. You get to start
right
at the point. I like how you said that maintenance. That's a great idea to look at it.
Yeah.
Like, it's like, you know, you got to take your car in for maintenance. You got to take your whole body in for maintenance.
Yeah. And then that thing, I'm sure we've all heard this, is like, oh, I'm just so tired. I just can't go. I always go. I mean, unless I'm not in town or if I have a house full of people or something, if I just can't. But it's like, because I've heard this a bazillion times. It's like, I was so tired. I almost checked out, but I'm so glad I came because this was just what I needed. Yep. That is huge. So that, and the thing about just, you know, bite the bullet, be vulnerable, because you're going to be surprised at the love and acceptance you can get in a circle when women are nervous to try that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There's a famous quote about that as well, something about being fully known and fully loved. And I think that's what we offer in a circle, that you can be fully known and fully loved after you're fully known.
Yes. I don't know if you can see this little plaque on the wall up here.
Yeah.
If you know that little kid's song, Jesus Loves Me, This I Know. Yeah. This says, Jesus knows me, this I love.
Oh, how cool.
I should have bought 100 of them, right?
Or you can just start making them.
Oh, yeah, right.
We could sell them in the women's walk store.
I have 6 kids and 17 grandkids. Probably not going to happen. I'm not a big crafter.
Me either. And can I buy that at Hobby Lobby? Because that's where I'll go.
Or Mardell's.
I don't know.
Or Mardell's.
Don't know. You might have to make them, Kim, in your free time.
Well, we know that's not happening.
Yeah.
Okay, so we'll go to our next question. What are some of your gifts that you get to use in Women's Walk, which I think we kind of said, but now you can elaborate on.
I know. It's kind of like, I kind of covered a lot of those before. The details are really helpful, you know, like with the spirit circle stuff and the list and the net throws and the notes and the list and things like that. So that efficiency part really comes in handy and trying to get to the end of something. And I really like to connect with one of my favorite things being, you know, the spirit circle coordinators want to get to have an individual conversation with somebody. That's those. I always really value those. Teaching and caring and compassion and honesty and boundaries. I get to use that. So here's kind of this firm part, because here's this like soft nurturing part, but then there's this like, okay, kids, that's enough, right? That mom thing. But it's about boundaries. It's about being firm, but kind, speaking the truth in love, but speak and also speaking a firm answer when you can't just say, okay, you can do that. You know, it's like to be firm, but kind. And to look at things that are really important for the greater good. No, it won't work to do this because that might suit you, but for the greater good, for the best choice for the greater number of people is going to be our decision. Wow. You know, yeah, period. You know, that's really important too. And then another part of like listening is a big deal, because there's different parts to listening. It's like, it's so nice to be listened to and not be interrupted. And that's what we can do in Women's Walk for each other. We get to like speak uninterrupted and say, and people know when we're done. And so it's not getting interrupted, right? So there's being listened to, there's listening to others. So that they feel valued. And there's listening for myself, like I need to listen to learn things. So it's kind of 3 parts of listening. I need to sometimes just shut up and listen and turn my head off and just listen, right? Yeah. So.
That's really good.
Yeah. It's hard to
self-awareness.
Especially, yeah, being women and moms. And I mean, you're just tuned into always listening and needing to respond. Sometimes you just have to listen and not respond. And that is hard. Yeah.
And sometimes because I've been in Women's Walk so long, well, in both of these, you know, even like the 12-step program I mentioned earlier, people there, you get to talk and you're never interrupted and there's not crosstalk and there's not interrupting and there's not giving advice. It's very similar in some ways, but I really have a hard time with, and I even hate the word chit chat. Do you want to chat? Nope, but I'll talk with you. Right? Like small talk about things that in my momentary judgment at that time don't matter. I'm like, I have a hard time with that.
That's good. At least you know that.
Yeah. And you sometimes I can do it. But
you're like talking about the weather or sports or anything like that.
Well, yeah, sometimes. I mean, you know, there's a moderate amount of things, because maybe that sports thing is interesting and details about small things that aren't like vastly spiritually important, right? There's interesting things in all those areas too, but just to have a long conversation about nothing that matters very much. Yeah, no.
Yeah. Not your speed.
Excuse me, I have to hang up now.
Yeah.
I got things to do.
Yeah, we're done. Yeah.
Oh.
I get that.
Okay, so our last question in this section is, what is one of the most impactful things a wise woman has told you? Or maybe it wasn't a wise woman, it was just another sister.
Mm-hmm. So I gave some thought to that. Just that from my weekend, I remember, don't you hate when a name falls out of your head? But anyway, one of the originals, she just said, what's a pearl that you got out of the weekend? It was a wise thing at the very end. Anyway, she says, what's a pearl that you got out of the weekend? And I said, gratitude. And I had this little tiny plastic fake pearl that I had in my coin part of my purse for years. I finally kind of disintegrated because every time I would get out change, I would see gratitude, right? Wow. I would see that pearl. And it would remind me of her, and it would remind me of gratitude. And gratitude is one of the first words in my mission statement too. So that was just a little thing. My weekend, I was in a strange place. I'd been living through more than 5 years of deep fear with just a lot. It was like five concentrated hardest years in my life. So I wasn't in a real open, trusting place. Out of all that fear, I had a lot of distrust. So I did my weekend not as who I am in my best. I came in very shrouded in defensiveness and distrust because of all that fear. So it sounds strange to say this because I've been in it so long, but I didn't get a whole lot out of it. And then there was a whole year before I did my weekend, and before I did my what we call now is a bridge, used to be a journey, and it was 8 weeks, once a week meetings for 8 weeks. And I did that. And I came into that I started to get more out of it, having that concentrated time to think about some of these spiritual things, right? And the sharing and stuff. So I'm going to say like the greatest important things about like wisdom from people was, it sounds a little off, but I was invited to almost every part of Women's Walk I got started in. I was invited to that first weekend by some women who knew me. I was invited to the second stage by way of a friend rushing up to me in the room where we had coffee after church, a year after my weekend, saying, oh, are you doing that journey that starts Wednesday night? And I went, I don't know. It's like Wednesday. I don't know. I wonder if I could. And I came home and this was like, all my kids were home. We had a million activities. I had 6 Wednesdays open on my calendar.
Wow.
And I called Beth. Yeah. And I called Beth Maloney, who had kindly invited me to a journey a few times during that year. And I'd say, I can't. And I called her and said, Beth, is there room? And she said, of course. Well, it was really crowded and there was a whole lot of people. And she just said, of course. So that was, so yeah, other people making space for me and inviting me in. And then I don't know if you guys even knew this woman named Patty, who was one of the originals. Then Patty invited me. So I just got into the circle and Patty was part of that. And then Patty said, I want you to help me co-facilitate a journey. And I said, am I ready? And she said, yes. And then she says, Lucy, when are you going to staff a weekend? And I said, huh? Am I ready? She said, yes. So Patty like led me into almost everything. She goes, oh, you would be great to be the health coordinator. And I went, huh? And I said, okay. So yeah. And then she says, oh, we have this little spirit circle team that we work on stuff. Would you like to join into that? See if there's anything you'd like to offer. And I said, okay. So here I am. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, yay, so, thank you, Patty, for asking and inviting.
Yeah. And it's like, I kind of think of it as like my, I love basketball. I played basketball. I lived for basketball in junior high and high school. I was also a good student, but I lived for basketball, right? My 8th grade coach saw potential in this skinny, gangly, totally uncoordinated person who fell more than anybody. And he worked me really hard. And when I got into high school, I wasn't on the varsity my first year, but the varsity coach saw my potential, and he had me practice with the varsity sometimes and work really, really hard and develop my skills because he saw my potential. So I feel like these women who invited me into things, the Women Walk, saw my potential, which is really like, that's a such a heart thing that like people didn't see me just as awkward or gangly or tripping all the time or whatever, or too serious or too quiet or too, I don't know, whatever, right? That people saw things in me that I didn't necessarily, that I wanted, but I didn't necessarily see in myself, and invited me in so I could go for it.
I think that's awesome.
So thank you, Coach Fletcher. Thank you, Coach Hamilton. Thank you, my Women's Walk people that saw my potential.
That's awesome. And that's where you gain all that stuff, by being in circle, and women get to see that, and they get to see the gifts that you don't get to always use and know different things about you. So I think that's awesome.
And right here, I'm going to say, thank you, Mom and Dad. I thought my parents were too darn picky. I thought they were too strict. Well, like kind of, but I was okay because I wanted to do right things and not get into trouble. So that was okay. But I thought they were too picky about the details of tasks they taught us. But I'll speak for myself and not my brothers. They taught me lots of stuff. And because they taught me right, I know how to do a lot of stuff, you know? And so I have to say thanks, Mom and Dad. And they also, even though I had to fight for it sometimes, they let me go ahead and go my direction, you know? So I'm going to say publicly here, thanks, Mom and Dad. And they were both very smart, very good people. And my mom is still living. Yeah.
That's very nice to say.
Well, and I have to say this, in honor of my dad, Dad didn't like my social life very well because he was afraid for me, right? He was overprotective. But when I did farm work or ranch work with my dad, we were 100% in sync. And I could knock down a fence post with the plow. I could ruin the tire on the tractor, whatever. I know Kim's going, what?
Wow.
And he never yelled at me for that. It was like, don't, it happens sometimes. We'll fix it. Isn't that cool?
But it's cool.
Yeah. And it began me apparently in my career for wanting to work with mothers, pregnant mothers and babies, because my favorite thing to do always and still is to go out and look through the cattle during calving season. I just did it last month with my brother to look to see what heifers were calving and if they needed help.
Oh. Really? You still do that?
Yeah. My oldest granddaughter, Kaya, is about to turn 23. She and I went to Texas to visit my mom, and it was calving season. I said, Steve, Kaya and I want to look through the cattle with you. And we did. So I got to introduce my granddaughter to the pregnant cow thing.
That's cool.
I know. I love that.
Something I didn't know about, Lucy. That's interesting.
I know.
Yeah. How many cattle does your mom have?
It's my brother.
Oh.
I mean, my mom and my brother still live on the farm and ranch, okay, but they're Steve's herd. Yeah. 200.
Wow.
Yeah. We're like homesteaders. Like it was my great, great grandpa got the land, and then my granddad, and
wow, that's super cool.
Well, we enjoy learning so much about you and the calving and the tractors, and who knew all of this about you?
Yes, that's why I'm strong. Yes.
Thank you for sharing with us.
Thank you.
So now we will go into our fuzz part of our show, our funny fuel for funny Fridays. Before we go into our faithful fuel for Friday.
Excuse me.
And a lot of you have told us in the past that you watch our show on Fridays because it drops on Thursdays on Facebook and on YouTube. And so we decided to call this part of our show your funny fuel for Friday, to fuel you into your Friday.
And now it's, like, isn't it funny?
So these are sort of like rapid fire questions. Our first is, what is your favorite meal? And it can be breakfast, lunch, or dinner, homemade, or a restaurant.
Well, it would be dinner at a Mexican food restaurant, and it would be the right kind of chili relleno, I was always in the perpetual search for the perfect one, and also a bean burrito with lettuce inside and cheese and green chili sauce. Hmm. However, I cannot eat either one of those anymore because of my dietary restrictions. But I remember.
Dang it. We'll have to figure out a way to make a chili relleno that you can eat.
But without the cheese in the middle,
maybe lactose free cheese.
Well, we'll talk about that another time.
Okay, we'll go to the next bump, bump, bump.
Put a pin in that.
It's a long story.
What is your best or worst movie you have ever seen? Or what is your favorite movie?
Well, one of my favorite movies is Fried Green Tomatoes. Have you guys seen that?
Yes.
Yeah. So it's a great women's story because there's three women that have entirely different stories going on, or four, and how they merge and how it's like a long time ago and how it's now. Well, I love, what's her name? The woman who's her husband's ignoring her, and then she starts working out and she's doing all this stuff. Kathy Bates. Yes. My favorite part with her is she's in the parking lot. She's got her blinker. She's going to take that parking space. And the young woman pulls in and says, "Face it, lady, I'm younger and I'm faster," or something. Oh. And she goes, and she backs up and says, "Tawanda." And she rams the car, not once, but two or three times. And then the girl goes, "Oh, you ran into my car." And she goes, "Face it, honey, I'm older and I have more insurance." Go, Tawanda.
Right. It's an empowering movie.
It's a very classic scene in that movie.
Yeah, it's my favorite.
I love Kathy Bates.
She's really good.
She is.
What is the most fun thing you've done during the pandemic thus far?
I'm sure I've done a lot of stuff during the pandemic. What I came up with, I was like, one of my favorite things is the opportunities to take long walks outside, because with a couple of my best friends, just these long walks and being outside and being able to talk through all the stuff that was happening. And there are people that I'm really deeply close to for many years, and the spiritual parts and the frustrating parts and the family parts. And it was just really like special times for sanity and
lots of good things.
Yeah.
I'm giving you bonus points for so far your favorite movie has started with an F, Fried Green Tomatoes. Your favorite thing to do has been with friends. You're getting bonus points for continuing the theme.
And fried chili rellenos, because they have to be fried.
There you go.
They do. I like it.
Yeah. I'll go. This last one's not going to work, though.
So close. If you didn't have to worry about making a living, what would your dream job be?
My fantasy job has always been, and still is, to be a dancer. It's like floating and flying, and it's beautiful and it's graceful and it's fun and the ballet and then the flowy costumes and all this. So I have 4 out of 5 of my daughters did some dance. So I love to see the dance shows. And my youngest daughter is a dance instructor, so I still get to see her in her classes do some dance. But I love to watch dancing. It seems like it would feel like it was flying, some of the different kinds of things you can do. Oh. I definitely need some flowy costumes. Yes. Flowing, Margaret, flowing.
Flowing. Yes. Flowing flying dancer. I will accept this.
A double bonus.
5 out of 5.
That I could see you as a dancer, Lucy.
I've got good hand movements, right? Yeah.
You could be. I could see it.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. Maybe it pays well. I don't know.
It doesn't.
It doesn't? Okay. It doesn't.
There's very few at the top tier. Yeah.
That's about it.
Otherwise, not so much.
Oh, I love dancing. It's one of my favorite things to do. And singing.
I know. You're a good dancer.
Terrible at both, but I'll do that. Freely.
I think you're a good dancer.
Freely. I see what you did there.
You saw that? I squeezed it in.
Well, thank you so much for coming on the show and taking the time to talk to us. And we're just so grateful for everything that you do in our ministry. And for me personally, Kim said it in the intro as we were bringing you in, but you were kind of one of my first introductions to Women's Walk because you were the Spirit Circle leader on my weekend. And so you've been with me from the very beginning. And I'm just so blessed to call you a sister, and just so grateful for all of the gifts that you bring to us.
And just about that, because I'm like, this young woman came in and like, right, you were like, bam, bam, bam. You were in every stage, right? And I'm like, oh, I love it when young women come in and they continue, because I'm like, if I would have had this in my 20s, mm-hmm. instead of being introduced to it in my whatever I was, I don't even remember now. Oh my gosh, maybe I wouldn't have had those 20 angry years in the middle. Right. So, yeah. Come young people, come young.
Right. I say that every time. I love to see when we do staff on the weekends and there's new women. It's like younger. It's like, oh, yes, that's our future. That's where it's going. And mm-hmm. I see that. And I wish I remember when marriage, when I first got married.
And I remember when Kim Turner came in and she came in and got involved right on. And like, I remember the first bridge you and I did together, and I'm like, oh. And so then there was me and two other women, and we were like, how can we expand our team? And all three of us said, Kim Turner. And and you said yes, and there you are.
I did, for the same reasons you did. People saw my potential, and I loved that about it.
Yes, ma'am.
And now it's just Lucy and I on the team.
Who oh no, we have invite.
We have other people. Yes,
we do. We have spokes to our wheel. Yeah, we do.
But our original team has now become just the two of us. But that's okay.
It's okay. We got people helping.
We do. Yeah. Well, thank you so much, Lucy, for always watching our show and all of your positive comments. We really appreciate it. And thank you for
keep
walking on the weekend with me. I appreciated our time.
Okay. Adios.
Thanks, Lucy. Bye.
Bye.
I really liked what she said when she was talking about accountability. I wrote it down while she said it because I was like, wow, that's really powerful. She said, you can't change unless sometimes you are challenged. And it's just so true. Like sometimes you have to be pushed a little bit to be able to change. If you are always in your same old routine, and no one ever challenges you, how are you ever going to change? And so that's a beautiful gift that we offer. But she worded it so eloquently that I had to write it down.
She does. She says, I love that part about maintenance. Like, you don't really think about it like that, but it's true, you know? Because I even say that when I'm talking on Sundays when they're getting ready to get on to the next step. It's like, we've kept you in this little 44 hours, but now you got to go back to life. And our life doesn't go away. We still have to go back to it. And while we've gotten these tools to put in our tool chest, we got to keep adding to it all the time because there's new things that come up and our seasons change. And I mean, for you, since you went on the weekend, your life has completely changed, right? You're married. It's just, everything just changes so much. So you always need a different tool to use, you know? And I love that about that. And I love that she said that. She's right. I got to have my maintenance twice a month.
Yeah.
For my own sanity, well, for my family's sanity. Goodness gracious. Glenn always knows, when are you staffing? Isn't it about time? And I think I told you this too when I was talking to him. He said, I think you need to talk to Margaret about that. He just knows we need our maintenance. We need our women in our lives. So,
well, and as your life changed and as your family changes, I mean, you know, you keep needing to stay and use the tools, and that's excellent.
I like to joke and think work is going to be done at some point. No, it's never going to be done.
You'll never just arrive.
And I'm done. No.
And that's not the point, you know, because like that would mean your life would be really boring, right? And you don't want that, you know, like sometimes life is hard. And so because life is always changing, and you know, you can't ever rely on the sameness and you know, any kind of normalcy. What's normal? I don't even know what that is.
I'm pretty sure you and I were just not normal, Margaret. That's okay.
Well, but just, you know, thinking back to the pandemic, and like we were talking to Lucy about that, like who would have ever thought the world would have changed like it did? So it's like, I've been thinking about that a lot, like never say never, you know, whenever I say, oh, I'll never do that. Never say never. We do not know what the world was going to throw at us. Wow. So,
and that's what's
got to be ready.
Yeah, at least it does change, you know, and I'm constantly adding new people in my life, and it's awesome. It's cool. It's great to see, because you're right. I wouldn't want to stay the same. Why would I? What would be the point? You know, I know that if I look back at myself from June of 2012, I am definitely not the same person.
Yeah.
And I owe that a lot to the ladies and women as well. Well, and of course the Holy Spirit.
Definitely. Same.
Yes.
Same for me too.
Me too.
So we will continue with our fuzz, and this part of our show is the Faithful Fuel for Fridays, and our verse this time comes out of Isaiah 61, and I'm going to read verses 1 through 3 out of the NIV version, and then Kim will pick up, and if you want to read the same, or if you want to read different verses, chapter 61 of Isaiah is 11 verses. But this, one of my sisters and I were just talking about this last week, and it's just beautiful language. And the title in my Bible says the year of the Lord's favor. So starting in verse 1, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has set me to bind up the brokenhearted and proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort those who mourn and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of the spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord, for the display of his splendor. Such beautiful words, you know, it's just so kind of like I can see an image, you know, like Lucy was talking about dancing, and the imagery of this passage is just so flowing and free and continuing our buzz.
And as you're reading, I know mine is more different. That's not the word. Is different than what you were saying. And I'm looking at the New Living Translation. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me, for the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to confront the brokenhearted and proclaim that captives be released and prisoners will be freed. He has sent me to tell those who mourn that the time of the Lord's favor has come, and with it, the day of God's anger against their enemies. To all who mourn in Israel, he will give a crown of beauty for ashes, a joyous blessing instead of mourning, festive praise instead of despair. In their righteousness, they will be like great oaks that the Lord has planted for his own glory. So a little bit different, but still the same. It is beautiful how it all just flows together.
And festive. I like that too.
Right. It is. And I love the idea of an oak tree, because it's rooted and it's in the ground and its roots are constantly growing. And I just love that, to think of us as mighty oak trees, you know, beautiful, mighty oak trees. And they're wise. If you look at a tree, it has all these cracks and there's so much going on in that tree, and you can see so much just in its rings. And I think that's how women are, like the layers that we can peel back. It's beautiful to see. It's beautiful to witness and be a part of.
And as Lucy was saying, that's what we get to do in spirit circles, is peel back our bark a little bit to let women see the core of who we really are.
Right. And sometimes it's not pretty, and that's okay. You know, because we learn that we have to accept all of them. I think we say this all the time. It's your left and your right. You got to accept the good and the bad, because that's what's going to make the whole thing. And that's the best part about women's walk. Well, it's not the best part, but it is one of the best parts, is most women know you're good and you're bad, but they don't see that. They just see you as a person. And I love that. You're not judged by any of that.
And once you can say it out loud and identify it and acknowledge it, then that's when Jesus can heal it and can redeem it. And there's nothing unredeemable. There's nothing too ugly or too broken or too hard or too bad. It's not redeemable.
Yeah. Somebody said that too. I'm never too much for God. I'm always just perfect. And it's like, yeah, you know, sometimes you think, man, I'm a lot. A lot for people, but not for God, right? Like, he just loves us exactly how we are. We're never too much.
Did you see that Toby Mac Speak Life quote this week about how, thank goodness Jesus never says, this is the last time I'm going to put you back together. He's never going to say that.
Ever.
Toby's so wise.
Toby, we're still waiting. We will find you. I just know.
So now moving on to this part of our show called G-Walking, God on the Ground. And we were so grateful to get to hear from women that were staffing the weekend and getting real-time G-Walking moments that they had experienced. And some from past weekends. Nicole shared about hers from 2019. I love that. So if you didn't see that extra little bonus video that we posted, definitely go check that out, of our live G-Walking from the weekend that Kim was able to staff just last weekend. I want to give you an opportunity to share too, any of the G-Walking moments that you got to.
But definitely it's on our Women's Walk Facebook page if you want to see that. It's about 15 minutes, I think.
Or less, yeah.
Yeah, it was pretty good. Pretty fast. We tried to be fast.
And I loved seeing everyone since I wasn't there. I think that was really, like, that part was really great for me, and just feeling to see you talking to people, you know, because we're on screens all the time and I don't get to see you, but you are with the people. So
right. And it was very, very fortunate that our behind the scenes editor, Christy Willard, was there. So she was able to edit us a nice little video and put it on. And it was a lot of fun, because you didn't get to see the parts where people are like, okay, scene one, take two, sure, where's the makeup? Oh, I don't have makeup.
Where's the lighting director?
Right? It just became the funniest thing, but it was so much fun. So we did miss you very much. But so for me, I would have to say, having been that it was the first weekend since 15 months off, that it just, from the very moment that the staff arrived, there was just God all over the place. Like, you could just see it. And to be able to watch these, I want to say we ended up with 17 women as staff, I believe. Is that right?
Yeah.
17 women, to watch them each in their beautiful giftedness and their yes, constantly. There was never a no. There was never a question. It was just, yes, what should we do next? Yes, where should we go? To see these women be the actual hands and feet of Jesus is beautiful to watch. And we all had to give so much, you know, because there was a smaller staff, but it was so beautiful to watch and to just, it seemed like it was flawless. Like, we'd been doing it every weekend. Like, it just didn't change. And it was so incredible to watch these 17 women. And to get to know a couple that I didn't know at all, like, I'd never met Nicole. And so it was super nice to get to talk to her. But he just planned us so perfect in who we were with in our circles and who was doing this and who was doing that. And our logistics team was definitely the hands and feet. Like, they were just everywhere. And you could just see it in them, you know, and there was never a no. It was just a constant yes. And one of the most beautiful, well, two of my most beautiful G-Walking. One was being on anger, and just, I've never seen him so present and so visible in some of those parts that you actually could see him. Mm-hmm. And that to me is amazing.
That's all like spirit goosebumps,
right? And that's the only thing I can tell you about, but it was he was just there, and it was beautiful to watch. And then I think I shared it on the live post from the weekend. But Lucy, for me, Lucy is definitely God walking for me. She's been my nurturing wise woman for almost all of my testimonies. And she can say the most beautiful things. And I'm like, how does she know that? Or what? Like, she walked me back from my fear and just grounded me. She knew, I don't even know how she knew, but one of my favorite places in where I find the most peace is in my own backyard. And I can just sit there. And she, that was the first thing she said, I'm going to put you in your yard. You need to be in your backyard. And I'm like, how do you know that? Right? Like, just these different, and she would say something. And I'm like, does she even know I have that in my bag? How does she know that? She didn't. She just listened to what the Holy Spirit was saying. And if you ever get time to spend some one-on-one time, like Lucy was talking about, she loves that. I can't tell you, take those 5-10 minutes and just let her ground you in. She has that peacefulness about her that just calms you and sets you down. And it's beautiful to watch. She is definitely God walking on. And man, I can't thank her enough for the healing that she's given me and the tools that she gives me every time. So she was definitely my big God walking moment on the weekend. But those 17 women being on the board for, I thank you all for your yeses and being the hands and feet. It was beautiful to watch. It really was. And I know it was a lot for us to ask and getting women to step into different things, but man, you ladies were amazing. And those 12 women were just poured into. It was.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, it really was. It's this ministry of his is so beautiful and just so thankful to be a part of it, you know, and I can't wait to see what the rest of the year has, but super exciting.
Well, yes, we thank those women and including you. You were one of the 17, so we thank you for your yes to staff. And we have another weekend coming up in Malvern, Pennsylvania in May. So we're super excited for that and super excited that we're doing weekends again. And so we'll have to check in with those women who are staffing that weekend to hear their God sighting moments and their G-walking. But thank you for sharing that with us.
My pleasure. Yeah, I certainly enjoy it. And I don't think either one of us are going to PA. So we'll have to bring some, maybe our behind the scenes, Christy Willard.
I was just going to say our wonderful editor could probably give us some inside information.
Don't edit that out, Christy Willard.
But as we wrap this up, we just want to say thank you to all of you for taking the time to watch the show. We just really appreciate your likes and your comments and your, even if you send us a private note to let us know that you saw it, we just, that brings both of us so much joy every time we gain a new follower or know that somebody's watching the show. And so we just thank you so much for your love and support and for watching. And if you have a G-walking moment, whether you staffed or not, please send it to us. My email is margaret@womenswalkwithchrist.org and Kim's email is kim@womenswalkwithchrist.org. And we'd love to hear from you. So as we sign off for this episode, we just wish you peace and good health, and we'll see you again next time.
Bless you all. Have a good couple of weeks.
Bless you.